What is your name and age?
My name is Julian Austin, Edward Julian Austin, and I'm 87 years old. I was born in Middle Tennessee over near Nashville.
When and where were you born?
I was born, as I said, in Middle Tennessee, but I moved to North Carolina from Johnson City. I've had several jobs in my lifetime and moved a number of times, but I've lived in Marion now since 1974, so you do the math and you see I've lived here longer than I've lived anyplace else.
What are some of your childhood memories?
Oh, you make me go back into the dark ages now. I can tell you one thing, it's you probably find it humorous. My first day at school, or first week at school, I spent the first 3 days on the playground. My brother was 2 years older than I was, and he brought me to school. But when it came time to go to classes, I didn't know where to go. I didn't know what I was supposed to do in the first grade. So I went out on the playground and played. And it kept much time. Well, then I'd get my mother packed the lunch in a bag for me. And at lunchtime, I would sit with everybody else and enjoy my lunch. And then when the school play time was over, well, then I'd go back to the playground. And about the third day, the principal of the school got my brother and took him out there and says, "Isn't that your little brother out there?" He says, "Yes, it is." He says, "Is he supposed to be in school?" He said, "Yes, he is." "So why didn't you tell me?" He says, "I wasn't going to tell on him." He says, "He was having a good time playing on the playground." So that was my first experience in school. I played on the playground for the first 3 days.
Why did you get to graduate at age 17?
My mother and father were both employed in the hosiery industry, making men's hosiery. And we moved quite a few times back and forth between Marietta, Georgia and Chattanooga, Tennessee. And it just so happened that we were living in Marietta when I went my first year in high school. But Marietta, Georgia only had 11 years in school, and Tennessee had 12. So when I moved back to Tennessee, I had completed the first year of high school, but I was a year younger than everybody else. So that made me graduate from high school at age 17. And everybody else in my class was 18.
What did you do after high school?
My goal in high school, a friend of mine was a year younger, as I said, and he had gone to Baltimore, Maryland to work up there in the Glenn L. Martin aircraft factory. And he came home riding a motorcycle. And to me, that was the most interesting thing in the world, is to ride a motorcycle. So my goal was, when I graduated from high school, I went to Baltimore to the Glenn L. Martin plant and worked on B-26 bombers with the idea of making enough money to buy me a motorcycle. But being of sound mind and body, I could spend it all before I got enough money to buy a motorcycle. And I had to ride the bus back home when it came time for me to be drafted. When you were 18, when I was 18 years old, the draft had been in effect for 2 or 3 years, I guess, before that. And whether you wanted to go to the service or not, you went. But my brother, as I said, was 2 years older, and he had gone into the Navy in 1970. And he was in Fleet Service School in Jacksonville, Florida, learning to be an aviation machinist when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, and they emptied the whole school and sent them all to Pearl Harbor. And I don't know what they did with the school after that. I probably filled it up with no more recruits, but he told me that he had seen how the Army and the Navy lived out there in Pearl Harbor. They lived in tents and ate out in the field, and he says, "I've got a warm place to sleep and clean sheets every night and 3 meals a day." Says, "Join the Navy when you have to join." So that was what I did. When I went in and did my physical, I qualified for the Army, Navy, or Marines. And I said I wanted to go into the Navy, and of course they took me right away. I spent 9 weeks in boot camp learning how to fold my clothes and wash my clothes, really, because we didn't do much marching. We did some, but it was ridiculous. Navy, you don't march. I'll tell you about that later. But when we completed boot camp, I was given a 10-day leave and came home and went back and reported back to Norfolk, Virginia, to the Naval Receiving Station to be assigned somewhere in the Navy. And after 2 weeks there, I was assigned to a destroyer escort, and the whole crew was taken out of that receiving station in Norfolk and put on a troop train, and you wouldn't believe where all we went to go from Norfolk to go to Orange, Texas, which was where our ship was built. We went to Chicago and then did through the middle part of the country, and it took us 7 days on a train to get to travel from Norfolk to Orange, Texas. And we went on board ship, I think it was September of 1943 when I went aboard ship. And I stayed on the ship until I was discharged.
Please tell me about your experience in the Navy.
It was interesting to come from Middle Tennessee to Texas to go on board ship. And we went from Texas to Galveston, and then from Galveston we went to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, for a shakedown cruise. That's when you fire all the guns. People learn where they're supposed to be. There were probably, out of the 210 men on that ship, there were probably 15 of them had ever been to sea before. So the rest of us were just pure landlubbers. I got seasick going down the river from Orange, Texas, the Nueces River, from Orange down to Galveston. I got seasick because the ship was just very slightly moving, but it made me sick. From then on, didn't matter how bad it got, I never got sick again, thank goodness. Because we had one man that stayed sick for 3 weeks at sea one time, and we went to, that was when the ship was assigned a duty of escort convoys from New York to England. And he was sick from the time we left New York until we went to England and came back. They wouldn't take him off the ship over there. They brought him back to the States. So he's the sickest man I've ever seen, but I'm sure he got shore duty from then on. My war experiences were that I went, as I said, that one convoy we took from New York to Londonderry, Ireland, and we went across the Strait into Wales, and visited there and refueled and brought another convoy back to the States then. But the second convoy we took from New York to Casablanca in North Africa. And when we got left there, coming back to the States, we were detached from that duty and told to report back to New York immediately for a further assignment. And we were put with a hunter-killer group. There were 5 destroyer escorts and one baby flat top, baby aircraft carrier. And we all, our war experiences from then on were to hunt submarines. That's all we did. We'd go to sea and We never knew where we were going or where, how long we were going to be at sea until we ran out of fuel and had to go someplace to refuel then. But I've been across the Atlantic probably 15 times.
Please tell me about the capture of the German submarine U-505.
April the 9th, 1944, we sunk the U-515 off the Azores. And the next day, we sunk the U-68 at almost the same location. And the captain of the aircraft carrier decided that when that submarine came up, we fired at it until we sunk it. And he said that he would like to capture a submarine and get the code books that the submarines carried. And so he said the next submarine we got on the surface, we would, instead of firing big guns at it, we'd fire 40 millimeter and 20 millimeter until they abandoned ship, and then we'd go in and capture it. And on June the 4th, 1944, we'd been searching for this submarine for 2 weeks, I guess. We knew where he was. He'd gone from the port in France down to South Africa, down to the tip of South Africa, and then was coming back toward his home base. And we knew he was there. We knew he was in that area because the submarines came up every night, and they would radio back into Berlin and tell them where they were. And by triangulation, we could pick up a radio signal from one area and another area, and triangulation, we'd pinpoint that location where that submarine was. So we knew approximately where he was, but not exactly. We were running low on fuel, and everybody else was too in our task group. And we decided we'd go into Casablanca and refuel. And the aircraft carrier had planes in the air, and they signaled that we had to head into the wind for the planes to land. And everybody made their turn to head into the wind, the ship that I was on, the USS Chatelaine, was in the what we call the catbird seat. We were right behind the carrier to pick up any planes any pilots that didn't make it when they tried to land. If they didn't make it, sometimes they'd go off the front of the carrier, sometimes they'd hit the back end of the thing, because these pilots were like us. They were just young guys and inexperienced, but in this case, the entire squadron made a turn to the left and turned, and just as we made our turn, we picked up a sound contact on a submarine, and we told the carrier we had a submarine contact, and he said, okay, do your job then. And he said, we're getting out of here. There's no place for an aircraft carrier when there's a submarine in the area. And so we immediately, our sound contact showed us where the submarine was. And we went in and fired hedgehogs, which are small bombs. There's 24 bombs that go out and fall into a pattern in the sea. And if one of them hits the target, well, then they'll all go off. But in this case, we missed completely. But we still had sound contact on him. And we made a turn to the left and came back around. And when we came back around, we had a better contact, that we dropped depth charges on him. And we could tell that sound contact could tell you how deep he was. If he was 100 feet to begin with, they could tell if he's coming up, and they told us he's coming up. And one of the planes off the carrier flew over, and he could see the submarine under the water, and he fired his guns into the sea to show us exactly where the submarine was. And about that time, it surfaced. It came up at a pretty steep angle. And when it did, but then instead of firing our 3-inch guns at it, the biggest things that we had, we fired 40 millimeter and 20 millimeter. And the crew abandoned ship. And we had a quail boat in the water immediately to go over to board the submarine. But we were told by the commander of our squadron, it happened to be on another ship, to pick up survivors, and that they would board the submarine. So that's what that's what happened. We picked up 48 men, so 48 survivors, including the captain of the submarine. And the other ship, the Pillsbury, went alongside to try to take the ship under the submarine under tow. And when the Pillsbury went alongside, the diving planes on the submarine protrude 8 feet, I guess, out from the side of the ship. And that makes the submarine go up or down. And when it came up, well, then the planes were still extended. So when the ship came alongside, those things ran right through the side of the ship. And they almost sunk the Pillsbury. But we were still told to pick up survivors, which we did. And we went alongside then, and not alongside it. We went close enough that we could get a line from our ship back to the submarine, and we started trying to tow it. But we were a what's called a diesel electric. We had diesel machines, motors that ran and to generate electricity, and the electricity that ran the motors, the propellers of the ship. So when you try to pull something that's twice the size of what we were originally, we just almost just sat there and just spun our wheels because we didn't have enough power to pull that thing. So the carrier said, "Okay, we'll tow it." And so the carrier came back, and after, I don't know, probably a half a day, we got a line to the carrier, and they started towing it. They towed it for a day, and the fleet tug came out from New York to help us tow it back in. But we pulled that submarine back into Bermuda and kept it there until the war was over. We captured all of the the Enigma machine, and this is a picture of the whaleboat alongside the submarine, all the men on that. We captured the Enigma machine and all of their code books. I think there were 800 pounds of code books. And to explain that further, the German Navy had divided up the Atlantic Ocean into what's called grids, squares, and each grid had a letter of alphabet in there, and then it also had numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4. So that if they were in C1, we had their code books, then we knew exactly where they were. When all the submarines came up at night to report back into Berlin where they were, from then on, we knew exactly where they were, and we just had a good time chasing them down and sinking them then. Altogether, our squadron was responsible for sinking 5 submarines and capturing 1. So we were pretty successful. This is a picture of the U-505 at sea with the whale boat alongside with the men capturing it. And is also, I don't think, we're pretty close to the background This is a picture of the submarine and my ship. Shows you how close we were to it when it came up. When the submarine came up to surrender, my job is as depth charge captain. I was in charge of throwing the depth charges over the side that brought the thing up in the first place. But when it came up, my job was finished. I didn't have anything to do then except to be the spectator. But it came up so close to me that I had a big wrench there that we used to set the depth on the depth charges with. And I threw that wrench at that submarine because I thought I could hit it. But it looked like it was that close, but it really wasn't. It was probably, I think, 700 yards away, which is, at sea, it looks awfully close.
What is the one thing you want people to remember about you or to know about you?
That's a good question. It's a good question. I was married while I was on leave just before the war was over. I was married on August 14th, 1944, or 45. And the war was over. Japan surrendered that same day. The day I was being in the church being married, bells were ringing and whistles were blowing, sirens were blowing, and we didn't know what was going on in the church. We thought there was an emergency someplace. But when after my wedding was over, then they told us that the war was over. And I thought, well, that was great. I did have to go back, report back to the ship, and be discharged. I was discharged in December of 1945. But I was married in 1945. So you do the math, you can figure that I've been married 67 years now to the same woman. And I guess I courted her when she was 14 years old, probably. She was very young. But with our courtship and my years in the Navy and then coming back to get married, it's just very memorable to me. She's special to me.
Thank you for letting me interview you.
It's been a pleasure.
That must have been a really good day since right during your wedding the war ended.
Yes, it was. It really was. Ironically, I hadn't seen my brother in 4 years, him being in the Pacific and me being in the Atlantic. But he was stationed in Hutchinson, Kansas, after the war was over. And he didn't know that the war was over then either. But we decided we would go to Kansas on our honeymoon. As good a place as any to go and do to kill two birds with one stone. So I went to see my brother and I had a honeymoon too, mostly on a train.